Censorship has existed ever since societal dynamics have. In fact, one of the earliest cases of censorship that I remember studying about was the period of Renaissance, where the church in the Roman society was one of the most authoritative institutions. And they decided to censor science. Surprising, because science is one of the most effective machinery that helps us move towards progress and development. So this institution decided to censor science because it questioned the ideals and teachings of the church ever since it existed. But today we live in a world where it is one of the most powerful tools that we use. If you've kind of observed the concept of censorship, you understand that a lot of what is censored comes from a creative space, whether it be art or literature. Take, for example, M.F. Hussain's famous painting, or say Salman Rushdie's Satanic Verses. But I would also like to show you a report by UNESCO, which states that there were recorded 1,028 cases of censorship towards the field of art and literature. 40 threatened, 16 attacked, 3 killed, and 840 censorship cases recorded. If you've lived in this country for over 25 years and you've been politically aware, I'm about to show you a picture that will ring a bell and also make you extremely uncomfortable. Now, this movie was criticized. The actor, the directors, the entire theme of the movie was criticized because it spoke about homosexuality. But we know that this very year, the world and this country not only accepted it, but certain sections of the society also celebrates it. The next two pictures that I'm about to show you will probably be one of the fondest memories of your childhood. And you're also wondering, why is it being displayed, especially when I'm talking about censorship? Let me ask you a question. What if I told you that there was a school of thought, or say a group of people, who actually believe that these books should be banned, or that you should never read these books? Let's understand their reason. The first book actually was banned, or there was a debate about why it had to be censored, for two reasons. The first reason was that it used extremely casual language. But let's not debate on the kind of language we use these days, shall we? This book definitely contains better language. The second reason was it displayed the beautiful friendship between a black man and a white man. But surprisingly, the very country that this book comes from has had one of the most well-loved black presidents. So I believe that, like everything else, censorship is a double-edged sword. It ultimately matters who handles it. And when you look at it from that perspective, we as human beings decide what is appropriate, what is morally and ethically correct to be propagated. And we're also the people who decide what is blasphemous, heretical, seditious, incorrect, immoral, unethical, and disallow it from being propagated in the society. But not only with time has censorship evolved, but also at a particular frame of mind, censorship has so many different dimensions and perspectives in different geographical locations of the world. Let me give you an example. Winnie the Pooh, which was one of my personal favorite cartoon characters growing up, probably one that I would have never seen had I grown up in central England, because it's actually censored for two reasons. A, he's half naked, and it's also considered to be sexually dubious, which would mislead children. Another interesting example is this, a meme. One that is probably the most used language or communication between the youth today leaves me to surprisingly an amusement where I don't know how the youth of Australia actually communicates, because they find it extremely insensitive that people would actually create memes and try to portray emotions and expressions that people never said. Another example that's quite interesting is the internet, half of where my research is based off, and also a place probably you will be validating my research from, is actually censored in one of the most developing, powerful economies of the world, China. So censorship has evolved with time, because we as human beings are evolving constantly, our perspectives are evolving, and so has the concept of censorship. But from the crude way of how censorship was looked upon, because I remember reading that during the American Civil War, Franklin Roosevelt says that censorship is extremely important during war, and his own wife, Eleanor Roosevelt, revolts, saying, "So I can't tell people whether it rains or whether it shines in the place I live in?" So coming from that place of censorship where it's applied to a fault, we're now in a world where it's a lot more relaxed. But what I truly don't understand is that do we really need to censor things that come from a creative space? Because what I believe needs to be censored is this: hate speech, the illogical beliefs that move around in society, the kind of sentiments and expressions that people very insensitively portray that disturb and injure the very core of humanity and the human value is what needs to be censored. I will ultimately agree when Sigmund Freud says, "How much have we progressed? When in the Middle Ages they decided to burn me and now they burn my books. They may burn the pages, but the words will still fly." Thank you.